Welcome to the 13th Sunday after Pentecost, a service of worship where we hear some very startling words from our Lord today, as recorded in Luke's Gospel. How, unless we hate our families, even life itself, we cannot call ourselves Christ's students, his followers, his disciples. Invite you to listen with open hearts as we struggle with, wrestle with that difficult teaching of our Lord this day. With that, I invite you to pray with me as we begin in the name of the Father, and the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Direct us, O Lord God, in all our doings with your continual help, that in all our works begun, continued, and ended in you, we may glorify your holy name. And finally, by your mercy, bring us to everlasting life through Jesus Christ, our Savior and our Lord. Amen. Gospel according to St. Luke, the 14th chapter, beginning in the 25th verse.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Now large crowds were traveling with Jesus, And he turned and said to them, "Whoever comes to me and does not hate father and mother, wife and children, brothers and sisters, yes, and even life itself, cannot be my disciple. Whoever does not carry the cross and follow me cannot be my disciple. For which of you intending to build a tower does not first sit down and estimate the cost to see whether he has enough to complete it? Otherwise, when he has laid a foundation and is not able to finish, all who see it will begin to ridicule him, saying, 'This fellow began to build and was not able to finish.' Or what king, going out to wage war against another king, will not sit down first and consider whether he is able with 10,000 to oppose the one who comes against him with 20,000? If he cannot, then while the other is still far away, he sends a delegation and asks for the terms of peace. So therefore, none of you can become my disciples if you do not give up all your possessions." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Something heart-stopping about our gospel lesson today, because where we might expect our rabbi to offer commentary on the fourth commandment, instead he seems to do the opposite. Not honor your father and your mother, but hate them along with wife and children, brothers and sisters, yes, hate even life itself if you want to be my disciple. Now the other gospel writers do soften this sermon. "Lest you love me more than your mother and father, more than your very life, you're not worthy of me," is how Matthew's gospel diplomatically puts it, and that's a helpful gloss. But leave it to Luke the physician to tape those AED pads to our chest and deliver a shock. It's as if for Luke, the urgency of our condition leaves no time for a gentle bedside manner, because lives hang in the balance. So Luke calls out clear and then shocks us again with Christ's words, "None of you can become my disciples if you do not give up all your possessions. The last time I preached on this passage, I shared about my experience of losing family and possessions in divorce and what that is teaching me about how easy it is to mistake our love of the good things God gives us for love of God himself. God, who loves creation selflessly, who loved creatures like you and me into existence, yet we are incurvatus in se, as Luther often said, we are turned in on ourselves. We are self-interested lovers, loving the things of this world, not for how they draw the soul toward Christ or lessen the suffering of others, but for what they can do for us, how they can make us feel. That's what makes our Lord's words here so shocking. He who loves my family more than ever I could now wants me to hate them. And yet I'm called to be Christ-like. So which is it? Every time I come back to this lesson, I am shocked by this teaching. Because who among us recognizes themselves in this description of a disciple of Jesus? Everybody knows you love your people first and then your stuff second. That's the proper order in the value hierarchy. But now our Lord comes along and says, me first, above family, above stuff, above life itself, me first. Not because you shouldn't love your family, not because it's wrong to own things, but because apart from me, you cannot love them rightly. Now, one way to understand this teaching is to recognize that Christ loves us too much to leave us to be ravaged by our false loves, vulnerable to, unprotected from our ego. And so he comes to demonstrate a love that doesn't possess, that doesn't grasp, that doesn't use and manipulate, that doesn't place self at the center. He comes to teach us how to hold persons and things lightly so that our hands are free not just to carry our own cross, but to help others bear up under theirs. Our Christian tradition has a name for this. It's called progress in the moral life. It's called growth in virtue. It's called the proper ordering of our desires, which we cannot do on our own power. That in itself is a controversial teaching in our time because our culture is fixated on self-help. But the problem with this presumption that we can save ourselves is that it's ourself that is so often the problem. So that the self is saving itself from itself, and that self is damaged. How well is that working out for us? This striving to be holy, to be virtuous, is a lifelong struggle, which entails surrender to and cooperation with the Holy Spirit. And it can be messy and confusing. And frankly, progress in the moral life often looks like falling down again, repenting of sin again, getting up again, and starting all over again. And as God works to shuffle our loves around and reorder our desires, this can be painful. But it is all for our God, all because God loves us and wants to restore our hearts so that they beat in time with his. And yet we know they are so often out of sync, which is why Luke brings those paddles this morning to shock our hearts back into rhythm. And I think we intuit this, that there is no goodness, no truth, no beauty apart from God, because everything radiant in this life is merely a reflection of his more perfect radiance. Which means this God we worship isn't just a moral exemplar, but summum bonum, the supreme good. And if God is the supreme good, then every other claim to supremacy has to get in line, has to fall in place, has to bow down before the summum bonum, the highest good, this perfect love. Conceptually, it makes sense. but at the level of my heart, my passions, my motivations, I'm not there yet. Like so many of us, I struggle with a divided heart. I want to love God, right? But I also want to love the good things of this life, pleasure, because I fear suffering. I don't want to struggle. I want to hold on to my power, my status, whatever it is that gives me comfort, right? But if God is the summum bonum, true comfort can only be found in Him. And maybe we think we've pretty much already achieved that. Maybe we're later in life and we figure, yeah, I think I've got it all figured out. You know, it's so easy to trust God when we have all we need. It's so easy to imagine ourselves to be sufficiently virtuous when our virtue isn't being tested. The truth is, the things we esteem most, the things we would risk everything for, family, finances, country, power, sex, reputation, influence, that is what we come to truly worship. And everything else then revolves around getting and having and maintaining those things. When all those loves are best enjoyed when subordinate to and ordered toward the one who is love itself. So in the end, our Lord is not disparaging our drive to possess those things which are needful, but He is warning us against our own self-destructive tendency to let things possess us, to mistake lesser goods for the summum bonum, when the highest good is to know and to love God, the God who gives shape and meaning and direction to all other loves, a God who so loved the world that He sent His Son to bear the cost of discipleship, to save us, and in so doing, offer up the very heart of God on that cross, Jesus, who did not consider equality with God something to be grasped or possessed or held tightly, but who considered it something to surrender, sacrifice, offer up for the sake of the ones He loves. So this isn't about our Lord denigrating the family, but about Him expanding our vision of family and what the family is for. And this isn't about Christians being destitute, but about a spiritual poverty that leads us to hold things so lightly that we begin to realize they aren't just ours, but they belong also to the poor and the needy. Jesus says that explicitly in the Gospels over and over again. And the earliest Christian writings all agree. St. Basil the Great famously preached his shocking sermon. He said, we should call a thief any man who could clothe the naked and does not. Because the bread in our cupboard belongs to the hungry too. The coats unused in our closets belong to the ones in the streets. The extra pair of shoes to the one walking barefoot. The money which we hoard up belongs to the poor. In his homily, St. Basil is echoing the church's teaching. For 2,000 years, God gives us gifts, not just for ourselves, but for those in need. And it's a teaching that makes us uncomfortable because it flies in the face of everything society teaches us. But society isn't our true teacher. We are not to be society's pupils. Our Savior is Lord. We are His disciples. And He desires that every one of us learn spiritual detachment. Not just so that our possessions don't become idols, but so that the hungry are fed and the naked clothed. That's what every encounter with God is about in the Bible. God interrupting persons or tribes on their path and shocking them out of cardiac arrest. This is why we gather publicly for the hearing of God's word. This is why the whole of the Christian life is marked by prayer and struggle, because the shock will wear off. We will forget with time. But God knows we need to hear that message over and over again. God knows that it takes a village, God's village, His church, the community of faith, to help us count the cost of discipleship. Grow in virtue and persevere in faith and in hope and in love. And if a part of you rebels at the thought of this kind of discipleship, if this sounds too difficult, if the price tag sounds too steep, then maybe you're beginning to get it. The way of the cross is a process of dying to self and to selfish ambition. As a great Lutheran, Dietrich Bonhoeffer, taught, when Christ calls a disciple, he bids them to come and die. Doesn't matter whether you're a spiritual toddler tripping over your own feet like I am, or a disciplined runner lapping all of us like St. Teresa of Calcutta, the way of the cross is about struggle. And the thing about Mother Teresa is she kept running long after she ceased deriving any joy or consolation from her work. She kept striving because she trusted that God was the highest good. That even if she didn't feel it, that he had called her to care for the dying, to guard their dignity, and that in loving them rightly, she was loving God truly. Mother Teresa wrote in her journals that she did not feel the comfort of God's presence for the last 50 years of her life. This is actually a common occurrence in the great exemplars of our faith. But that's the thing about spiritual desolation. Those seasons in which the consolations of joy or safety or health or companionship or purpose are withheld or withdrawn. Such seasons can be deeply disorienting for individuals, for families, for churches. But they also shock us out of our spiritual stupor. They drive us to prayer. They move us to disentangle our hearts from all the false loves. Because if we love the consolations of God above God, what happens when those consolations are removed? Then what is it that we truly love, worship, trust? St. Paul tells us that the love of money, that is the love of our stuff and all that it leverages, that is the root of all evil. This kind of love, this overweening attachment to wealth, to property, to possessions, it is the root of all evil, Paul tells Timothy. And so God comes to us to root out these false loves. It's why he gives us his word, his spirit, his very body, because he wants his heart beating in our chests. A heart that beats not just for ourselves and our needs, but for the needs of others. And what holds us back, Bethlehem? What keeps us from letting go, from trusting God? Well, more than anything else, it's fear. Fear of suffering. And as Trappist monk Thomas Merton pointed out in his beautiful autobiography, The Seven Story Mountain, the more we try to avoid suffering, the more we suffer. Because smaller and more insignificant things begin to torture us in proportion to our fear of being hurt. That's what our good rabbi means by using the hyperbolic language of hate in Luke's gospel. Not willing harm toward others, not disregarding their needs, but letting go of the trivial loves that run our lives and holding lightly even to the profound ones that often rule our lives for the sake of that more perfect love which casts out all fear. That love is the one whom we gather today to worship. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
I have promised to serve you to the end.
scattered grains of wheat are gathered together into one bread. So let us gather our prayers, our petitions for the church, for those in need, and all of God's good creation. We pray for the church around the world and for the mission of the gospel. Refresh the hearts of your people. Deepen our understanding of every good thing we share and strengthen our partnerships in the faith. God of grace, hear our prayer. For the well-being of the earth and all its creatures, for trees and forests, for all that will yield fruit this season, for streams and all the bodies of water that keep our atmosphere and our land clean and strong, God of grace, hear our prayer. For the nations and those in authority, for elected leaders, grant wisdom to those who govern, raise up citizens who make decisions in the best interest of their neighbors. For students and teachers beginning this school year, protect, guide, and impart wisdom to each according to your great love, O Lord. God of grace, hear our prayer. For all in need, for those who suffer from disease, who struggle with homelessness or food insecurity, for those whose family life is difficult, for all in this community who need your care, especially those whom we name aloud or silently in our hearts before you this day. God of grace, hear our prayer. We give thanks to you, O Lord, for the saints who now rest from their labors, Mother Teresa and others who have in this life served you even when it was hard. Give us faith and stamina like them to love you with all our hearts, and by your mercy bring us to everlasting life. God of grace, hear our prayer. Gathered together in the sweet communion of the Holy Spirit, gracious God, we offer these and all our prayers to you through Jesus Christ, our Savior and our Lord. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Let the vineyards be fruitful, Lord, and fill to the brim our cup of blessing. Gather a harvest from the seeds that were sown, that we may be fed with the bread of life. Gather the hopes and dreams of all, unite them with the prayers we offer. Grace our table with your presence, and give us a foretaste of the feast to come.
Blessed are you, O Lord, our God, maker of all things. Through your goodness, you have blessed us with these gifts. With them, we offer ourselves to your service and dedicate our lives to the care and the redemption of all that you have made, for the sake of him who gave himself for us, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And now may the Lord bless you and keep you, make his face to shine on you, be gracious unto you, lift up his countenance upon you, and give you his peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.
so good, all your ways are sure. I will trust in you alone, higher than my sight, high above my love. I will trust in you alone. Where you go, I'll go. Where you stay, I'll stay. When you move, I'll move. I will follow you. When you love, I'll love. How you serve, I'll serve. In this life I lose, I will follow you. I will follow you. Light into the world, light into my